Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. This is the quietest it's been. Maybe because I stood up here longer than I normally do before I started. Usually it's a couple of good mornings before I think anybody hears it, which is a good thing. But there are a few things to mention as we are getting started worship together this morning here at our church. One is that on Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, our Bible study will continue. This will be Tuesdays at 10, starting this Tuesday and onward for the next 5 Tuesdays. We'll be talking about Moses. And so if you'd like to be a part of that, you still can. Just let me know, either by signing up on that sheet or texting me or anything like that, and I'll be happy to include you in that. Other than that this morning, also know that on Thursday this week, the men's group, the community men's ecumenical group, will be meeting here at St. Paul at 7. And so we'd love for you to come to that. I think I'm doing the devotion. Russell, I owe Russell a favor, you see, because he asked me to do it. Preach for me, so I couldn't say that. I knew without even asking that the answer was only yes when you asked. But very good. So I do hope you would come to that. There will be some food and some time and fellowship as well. So I do hope you're able to make it for either the men in our church. Other than that, I know that we'll soon be doing, we have had several of the giving tree things come back to us, and we'll be soon sending those off to be inscribed and placed on the tree down in the Family Life Center. So if you have purchased one of those, know that that's being worked on, and if you would still like to purchase one, you can, and that's in the bulletin as well. Very good. Other than that, are there any other announcements that we would like to lift up? I think just a helpful note is that the screens are not working. I think the power was the church this morning, and it's kind of messed everything up there, and then we'll get it fixed, but at least for today, we're going to go old school. That's good with it. Anything else? If not, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Let us set aside all that distracts us from true worship.
come and let us worship the one who calls us here.
We are here to worship with all that we are.
Amen. I invite you to rise for our invocation. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, you are calling us together this morning for worship, and we are thankful for this opportunity. Lord, as we gather, we pray that you would still our minds and our hearts and our spirits today so that we might receive a word from you. Lord, be with us now in our endeavor of worship. Fill us, Lord, so that when we leave this place, we might pour out your love into those we encounter. In Jesus' name, amen. I do invite you to remain standing as we affirm our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our first hymn together this morning is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It is hymn 400. YouTube, okay. Fancy change since I was a kid. Very cool. Well, today we're talking about a really famous passage of Scripture. It's Jesus who tells us, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest." Jesus says, "My yoke," which is something that they would put on oxen to train them. He's saying, metaphorically, "My yoke is easy, and my burden is light." And so that first part, though, he says, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened." And I thought we could do this together, and James is going to help me. All right, so you want to go ahead and stand up, James? So I thought a good way to demonstrate burden was to see how many books we think James can hold. All right? Do you mind holding out your arms? I will put one in, okay? Let's imagine that this is a burden. Maybe we know that this isn't the case because James is great. Maybe James got in trouble at school and now he's feeling guilty about it. How long do you think he can hold that book? Pretty long, right? It's a pretty light book. He could probably hold it for a good little while, but I bet if he stood there for a few hours, his arms would eventually hurt, wouldn't it? Yeah? Okay. So in the midst of James feeling maybe guilty about getting in trouble at school, oh, now he's sick. Getting heavy? No? Okay. You got to think of another burden. Yeah? Okay, well maybe James had a fight with one of his friends at school and now they're not getting along with each other. How long do you think James can hold those burdens? Good little while? Maybe it's still not heavy enough? Yeah? Well maybe there's another burden that James has to carry. Get tired? You sure? I have a 35-pound kettlebell in my office. I've had it. Michelle can tell you I brought that out first, but then I thought, no, we'll do books. Okay? All right. Well, then maybe another burden gets handed. Well, good. Then James is going to hold this the rest of church for us. Does that sound like a good plan, James? You think you can handle that for everybody? Yeah? Okay. Okay, well, what do you think would be helpful, James, rather than you holding all of this?
Preaching?
Okay. Yeah. I can tell you that's a different burden. That's really heavy. Yeah. Okay. Well, what do you think could help you with all of those books? What about some of these people?
James.
Will one of y'all go up there and help James? Okay. How about somebody else? Does somebody else want to grab one? We can carry those heavy burdens for a while, but eventually they're going to get really heavy. And eventually we're going to be tired of carrying them. And the worst thing we can do is think that we don't have anybody to help us. Right? But as you saw, you have people to help, literal people here today. And then we also have God who we can go to in prayer, who we can encounter when we read Scripture, we encounter God when we come here to worship, and we can turn all of those heavy burdens over to Him. Does that sound like good news? That like 80%, right? We'll put that one in the bank. Maybe it'll work better as a perfect. Thank you, guys. So we'll pray together and then we'll say goodbye. Gracious Lord, we thank you for these, your children. Lord, we pray your blessing upon them as they continue to learn and grow. Lord, we thank you for their faithfulness of stepping forward and helping us to understand, Lord, the way in which you help us to carry heavy burdens. Lord, you take them from us and give us in exchange, Lord, burdens that are light. Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. It is in his name we pray. We do remain in that same spirit of prayer now as we turn to the needs of our congregation, those that we have brought with us that are both praises and petitions. One I bring this week was Miss Terry Riddle, that spent some time at the hospital. this week. He was back home as of yesterday, but we'll be going back later this week for some more tests. So we want to be in prayer for Terry. Other than that, this morning, just because I've been doing it all along the way, every time I put a new one on, I hope it's not vanity to share these things, but I get questions and I'd rather just answer them all if I can at this point. This is a gift from my last appointment. As I was leaving there to come here, this is what they gave me. So if you think back to how nervous I was leading up to ordination interviews, I want you to know that when people give you a gift that you can't use until you accomplish something, you feel extra pressure to actually accomplish that which people have to put faith in you that you would. So, but anyway, this is from my two churches I pastored before here at the Cambridge Chapel. So that's where it came from. But other than that, are there any others that you would like to lift up for worship? Lift up for prayer. Yes.
Love the curtain. Here's my rest that I will remind you of. She's suffering from a man. She fell off the curtain.
It's lifting up Linda Kirk. Yes. Praise for Jerry Coleman. Thank you. Are there any others that you would like to lift up at this time? If not, let us then go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and everlasting God, we do come to you this morning once more with the needs that we have brought with us, those that we have both named aloud and those that we named silently in our hearts. Lord, for you know the needs that we have brought with us, those that are personally affecting us, those that are affecting those that we love, those in our community, those in our state, our country, and in our world. Lord, for all the need that is present, that is represented by those who have gathered here, Lord, help us to know that today that you can take these heavy burdens from us and exchange them for a burden that is light. Help us, Lord, to depend more and more on you and to depend less on ourselves. In moments like this, where we are dealing with things that are difficult, that are heavier than we're able to handle. Help us to know, Lord, that we have help, that you are our help, and that we can call upon you, Lord, each and every day, each and every day. And Lord, as we do gather, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, we thank you for this church that you have, Lord, provided us for a place of worship, a place of mission, a place where we can gather together and help and be strength for each other, strength for our community. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to be with us. Help us, Lord, to go to the places that we haven't been yet. Help us, Lord, to meet needs that we haven't met yet. Help us, Lord, to be faithful to the calling that you have given us, to go therefore making disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for this commission. And Lord, we thank you for all that you do for us, through us, and with us. And Lord, we thank you most of all for Jesus, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'll have our presentation of God's tithes and our offerings.
Mm-hmm.
yoke of the Bible that it describes doesn't burden us, but reminds us that you yearn for us to be a church, a community that supports, steadies, and sustains when life makes us weary. The gifts we give this day, we give in gratitude for this yoke that helps us finish the race in faithfulness. Bless our giving and its use, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. We turn to Matthew 11, where we will read together verses 16 through 19, and then jump and read verses 20 through 25. Hear now the word of the Lord. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. What I have found increases wisdom is not only the process of learning, but also through the process of unlearning. This is not any more apparent than when two people, I think, begin to live together who have never lived together before. It was this way in my life when my older brother and I started sharing a room in my parents' home. It was certainly this way when Sabrina and I moved in together after being married. My older brother had to get up super early back then because he had work in the morning. So I had to unlearn my habit of staying up late and making a bunch of noise. And then he had to unlearn making a bunch of noise when he got up in the morning. Because there was another 2 or 3 hours there before I had to get up, and making a bunch of noise, he never unlearned. He was good at it. Like a bull in a china shop, my brother. When Sabrina and I got married, we were, and I think she agrees, we were a mess,
right?
For the first 6 months to a year. She said, I'm the mess, is what she's pointing at. We were raised so very differently from each other. Her family was from New York, and mine was from North Carolina. She was raised with one sister. I have 2 brothers. She did pageants. I played baseball. Sabrina's family used dinner to catch up with each other, to talk about a million things. My family used dinner to unwind and start getting quiet. For that first 6 months to a year, Sabrina and I just found ourselves always on the opposite sides of deciding how things should be done. In my world, a mess will be there when I have time to get to it. In Sabrina's world, a mess shall not be there, and we won't have time for anything else until we get to it. Right? What I think has done us both good has been unlearning how we separately like to do things, not my way, not her way, but learning how we do them our way, which often looks her way. Some concessions. One of the most significant examples of this is when it came to shoes in the house. If you were a fly on the wall in our house those first several months after we got married, you would have heard spirited debates about whether one should or should not wear shoes in the house. I don't think you have to guess or know for me to tell you which one of us was on which side of that argument. But I thought it was more convenient to just leave them on, because I might have to quickly go back in and out of the house. I was passionate about this, but I quickly learned that Sabrina was even more passionate about it. And so this was one of those disagreements that I chose to concede on. There have been many. And it was decided that we were not going to wear shoes in the house, but it was probably a good year before I finally stopped forgetting to take my shoes off, because what was hard was not learning to take them off, but unlearning leaving them on. Do you hear the difference? Because for the first 22 years of my life, I wore shoes in the house. That's what we did. And now our young family was coming up with our way of doing things, our way of getting along. And we each had to unlearn how we had always thought the world ought to spin. Takes a second, I think, for two worlds spinning different directions to come together and find their own way of spinning. As it relates to more than just relationships, what I think is a necessary part of growing in wisdom is not always through the process of learning, but through a process of unlearning. We see in our passage something similar through Jesus' words about how both he and John the Baptist had been rejected by their contemporaries. Jesus makes the point that John was rejected because people said he was too harsh. He spoke too much about repentance. John was too uptight. Then there was Jesus, who his contemporaries said, not near harsh enough. Too full of grace. Too forgiving. He has too many parties with the wrong kind of people. What Jesus is highlighting is not that John the Baptist and Jesus were so different, but how they were the same in that both had come, one to point people to the kingdom of God, and the other to begin to usher in that kingdom of God onto this earth, and they were rejected for it. That's what John's highlighting. That's what Jesus is highlighting. And so what made them the same was that they were both ignored, they were both rejected, they were both persecuted, not because people were unwilling to learn from them, but they were unwilling to unlearn their preconceived notions of who God is and what the Son of God should do or say. John encouraging people to unlearn, to repent their sinful ways, in preparation for the coming kingdom, people say, no thanks. That's doing too much. And then Jesus leading those who are willing to follow him in unlearning what it means to be saved through force, strength, power, to what truly saves, which is grace, love, and forgiveness. No, Jesus and John's contemporaries thought they knew what Jesus and John should be doing, and remained unwilling to peel those expectations back, unlearn how things had always been, and then to be formed and molded into the likeness of the one who saved us not by avoiding death, but by going through it. It's this that is on my mind when I read the second part of the passage, the famous part. I thank you, Father, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. It is the first part of the passage that's on my mind when I read Jesus' words, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. What was getting in the way of the people following Jesus and experiencing peace and wholeness through Jesus was not a lack of knowledge or wisdom, but their unwillingness to put aside their ways, to put aside their thoughts, to unlearn how they thought the world ought to spin and sit at the feet of the one who was there when it began to spin in the first place. Jesus said that these things are hidden from the wise, they're hidden from the intelligent, but to the infants, he says, this has been revealed. The difference between the wise and the infant is obvious, isn't it? Us who are grown and full of wisdom, we're able to care for ourselves. We have learned through life's experience how to do for ourselves. We celebrate the milestones of learning how to walk, learning how to tie our shoe. We learn how to use a toilet. We celebrate the moments we become a little more able to do for ourselves. The problem is that I think we might be learning that a little too well. We have learned to walk, we have learned to stand on our own two feet, and we have learned how to depend as little as possible on anyone but ourselves. And so from the moment we're born, we've been learning how to be on our own. But somewhere along the way, we have learned how to do that beyond what enables us to live in the Jesus' way, which is rest, which is easy, which is light. When I read these words, come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, for I will give you rest. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Do those words sound like a possibility for you? Or is it just wishful thinking? Are we able to receive them like Jesus says the infant is? Or are we too wise, too intelligent? We've learned the hard way that if I don't carry these burdens, if I don't continue running, no matter how weary I feel, nobody else is going to do it for me. What I think makes passages like this one something we hope for in the future, but not something we feel like we can enjoy in the present, is the way we haven't only learned, but have mastered depending on ourselves, doing for ourselves, leaning on ourselves. What would it look like for you to unlearn the very wisdom and intelligence that is robbing us of the peace, contentment, and joy that awaits us in depending on God for the stuff that is too big, that's too heavy for us to carry? What would it look like to unlearn the belief that the world only continues to spin because I run fast enough to make it? Something that came to mind as I thought about this was something I have never heard a parent say, not even once. I have never heard a parent say, you know, baby Sarah, she's just been worried about this weekend. You ever heard somebody say that about a baby? They're so worried this week. She's concerned about whether or not we're going to feed her tomorrow. It's just consuming her. She's worried. She might not get into that preschool that would give her a leg up on her peers. She's just so consumed lately. Her cousin, he was walking and he was her age. Now she just thinks she's getting left behind. She's worried. I have no doubt that baby's worried at different points, but the point remains, worry doesn't seem to be enough of an experience for infants that at least we as adults seem to notice it. I would have to talk to a baby sometime to find this out for sure, but something tells me that the ones that are in our nursery right now, not one of them, is worried about the kinds of things that are fresh on our minds today. They might be worried about when someone's going to come get them. But past that, and that's going to be resolved here in a little bit, all will be well again. Until it's nap time or they get hungry. But that's not worry, is it? The easy follow-up to that would be, well, Cameron, that's because we who are in here are working on their behalf to make sure that their world keeps spinning. We are working on their behalf to make sure that they have what they need in order to be well. And to that, I say to you, isn't there one who is at work right now in our lives as we sit in this nursery, making sure that our world keeps spinning? What those in the first part of the passage, the wise, the intelligent ones who said John's too harsh, Jesus, he isn't harsh enough, they were unwilling to unlearn their expectations of who God is, what God should do or say in the world. God came to them in the person of Jesus and they missed him. For what they saw in Jesus didn't match what they had come to believe God's coming would look like. And likewise, we who are intelligent and wise sometimes miss the way that Jesus comes to us offering us to let go of heavy burdens, to take on a yoke that is light, because we have learned something we are unwilling to unlearn. Dependence on things other than Jesus, and I would say, namely, ourselves. The belief that we alone make the sun rise and the moon set. That if it isn't me who runs until I'm weary, then nobody else is going to do it, and all will not be well. Hear something different. Receive the wisdom that infants understand and the wise cannot comprehend. Jesus is inviting us to unlearn our way of doing things, Karen's way. And instead begin to learn how to walk with the one who isn't teaching us to make it on our own, but is helping us to learn more and more that we can depend on him every step of the way. It is this, that while we teach infants the things they need to know, they can help us to unlearn the things that are harming and not helping. Infants reveal that what it means to follow Jesus is total dependence on Jesus. Letting Jesus carry the heavy burdens, and in exchange we carry burdens that are light. We peek into the crib and we see that infants lead us in a more excellent way because their entire existence, their whole world, depends on how we take care of them, somebody else. Meanwhile, we believe our entire existence depends on how well we help ourselves. How misguided we are to believe that we stand this morning because we've got ourselves. That there haven't been countless people who have loved us all along the way, who have picked us up when we had fallen, even carried us when we couldn't go any further ourselves, and even more, that we neglect to remember the God who so blessed us with those people, who continues to do the truly heavy work in our lives that we might not always see, but is there ordering our steps that we think we're taking all by ourselves. Jesus says, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Learn from me. All I want to offer you is that what I have observed about how we learn something new, that the process of learning often includes a process of unlearning. And if we're going to learn the wisdom that has been hidden from the wise and revealed to the infant, then we have to get all the way back to that place that our total existence depends on another for our well-being. And then from that place, we will see that the one who is in control is able to be strength for us when we are weak. One who is able to not just help us lift heavy burdens, but takes them from us. And then gives us burdens that are light. Hear words today that don't just have to be hope for tomorrow, but a gift for today. A gift we can receive if we would be willing to learn who truly is the one who is in control and unlearn the way we have believed it's us who sets the sun and raises the moon. Hear these words. Come to me. Come to me. All you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, for my yoke is easy and my burden. I'm reminded this morning of the words of one of my seminary professors who said, don't be the kind of preacher, the kind of Christian, who doesn't take the medicine they prescribe. Prayer, spending time in God's Word, serving God through serving others, worship, fellowship. What helps us live into invitations like the one Jesus is offering us this morning is to do those things that connect us with God and each other. Back when I heard that professor say those words, what my spirit heard him saying is that we often neglect the very accessible way that we can more perfectly live in relationship with God. Maybe if we could just unlearn whatever has lied to us to make us believe that there isn't joy, that there isn't peace, there isn't hope waiting for us in those places of quiet. The places we don't seem to ever have enough time for. Because our heavy burdens won't give us a reprieve long enough to take the medicine that our souls need. I can tell you, as a person who has unlearned leaving his shoes on when he gets home, there is fruit. There is fruit waiting for us when we are willing to unlearn whatever. whatever has made us believe that peace, that rest, that burdens that are light, and yokes that are easy, are just not blessings we're ever going to know. Unlearn that. It's a lie. And when we do, we will begin to learn a more excellent way from the one who gives us rest, the one whose burdens are easy, and the one whose yoke is light. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And while she's making her way up, I'm thankful for Michelle today, who you didn't know could play the organ, did you? She could hit play on the organ. Okay. I do invite you to rise for our final hymn. It's Open My Eyes, hymn 454. Christ offers his yoke to you, promising to come alongside you and stick with you no matter where your journey takes you. So when your week gets hard, when you feel like you're at your wit's end, when the overwhelm is too much, Christ holds out his yoke to you.